All right, good afternoon. So the management of an acute stroke patient can be thought of simply in three broad categories. The first being the acute management, as we've talked on much of the day, to lessen the severity of the stroke, to avoid the complications that could rise relatively in the immediate aftermath of that stroke. Second then is to investigate why that stroke happened for that patient, to be able to put together the best plan to prevent that from happening again. And then lastly is rehab. So pardon the term lastly, I shouldn't use that, but the point being is that all three of these things can be thought of kind of at the onset of that patient coming in. And in fact, practically, we're using Epic. The order sets involve all three of these things for the admission orders. So it's my privilege to talk a few words on recovery after stroke. So to start, I think back to actually the amazing process of neurodevelopment, because it's going to lead and provide necessary context. So it's really one fascinating feature is the synaptic connections that are formed in development. They're critical, and they're just innumerable, and they underlie primary circuitry, motor, or sensory. They underlie then the adjacent supplementary circuitry that's going to then modulate those primary modalities. And then the increasing complexity then to the circuits that are spatially distributed but yet work together as a functional network to underlie our more complex functions of attending to and interacting with our environment. Formed in development, these synaptic connections are then sculpted by experience and by use. And so ultimately, there's these cortical somatotopographic maps that are formed, and they're necessary for our optimal function in our environments. Key animal model experiments have taught us about the nature of neurons, their natural characteristics, what they like and don't like. For example, if you amputate the digit from a limb of a mouse, now you have a sensory cortex that all that mouse's life has been receiving signal when that digit was stimulated and receiving continuous proprioceptive information as to where that digit is in space. That input is now gone with amputation. What's the neuron to do? Well, a voltage-gated dye imaging has allowed us to understand that, in fact, that neuron takes on function of adjacent sensory cortex to represent neighboring digits from that similar limb. So it doesn't want to be idle. It needs that sensory input. Similar, if you, by experimental model, induce a stroke to, again, in a mouse scenario, their forelimb sensory cortex. Well, now you have a limb that can still be stimulated. It's still in space, but the receptive field in the cortex has been injured. What's found, again, by similar mechanism, is that stimulation to that forelimb, those signals can be found in adjacent, in this case, hindlimb sensory cortex, or nearby, even sometimes in ipsilateral motor cortex regions. So surviving even peri-infarct regions have a sense that they need to have a function, they need to have a purpose, and if there's an injury such that cuts them off from their usual supply of information, they're going to even compete with nearby regions to have a role. So mechanism underlying development, neurodevelopment, is very timely and perfectly orchestrated balance of neurotrophic factors. Neurotrophic factors that are going to be promoting of axonal sprouting, elaboration of more dendritic spines to facilitate all that synaptic connection that's necessary, balanced with those that would inhibit that process so it's not overdone. So what's interesting is that, again, in the animal models, they found that after stroke, there's a reemergence of a similar profile of neurotrophic factors. And importantly so, the balance, if you focus just on the solid lines, initially favors the promoting factors, those that would encourage axonal sprouting, elaboration of more dendritic spines. If you were to, again, in an animal stroke model, withhold a rehabilitative effort and delay that until 30 days in this scenario, probably not surprising to you, you have very little noticeable recovery you can attribute to your rehab effort. If you were to do that earlier, say day 14 or even day 5, now you have some measurable response actually of recovery that you can now attribute to your rehab effort. So the point being is that with this lead time of promoting neurotrophic factors, is there a critical period where the brain after stroke is most receptive to rehab intervention? So a group in Australia took on the challenge for this question in their patients that come in with stroke. Mostly one of two centers contributed 70 patients for the plan of a feasibility safety trial. Their target was to implement early mobilization, implementing rehab early within 24 hours of stroke symptom onset. And in addition to that, they wanted to be more intense with their effort. They wanted to double the mobilization time that's accumulated over the length of their acute care stay compared to that of standard care. So they achieved their goals. The very early group, median time to first mobilization was 18 hours, and time out of bed basically through the stay was 167 minutes compared to the standard listed there below. So it's feasible. The bottom line for safety was that there was no statistical significance of difference in death, serious adverse events, falls, or even clinical deterioration. So with this early data, not powered necessarily for efficacy though, but just taking a look at what they produced with just these 70 patients, again, good outcome being defined by, as has been said all day, MRS 0 to 2. You can see when you compare standard group on your left compared to very early group, at 3, 6, and 12 months, there's certainly trend of improvement or more odds of better outcome. And then when you adjust in the far right, when you adjust for the age of the patient, the stroke severity, and their premorbid functional status, at least at 12 months, you get actual statistical significance of increasing the odds of better outcome. So the next step then is to prove this effect of efficacy of the intervention in a larger trial. So a collaborative effort, 56 stroke centers, 5 countries, Australia, Singapore, Malaysia, the UK, might be missing one. They all accumulated a little over 2,000 patients, and they had similar goals to the phase two that I just mentioned. So they wanted to get them up out of bed, time to first mobilization target, less than 24 hours. They wanted to make sure they had more intense rehab effort. They also did a, for all of the patients, not just the very early group, they did kind of a dose a dose of rehab that was daily assessed based on that patient's functional ability that day. So to straight to the point, when we compare the modified Rankin distributions, the very early mobilization group on top, the darker blue represents your better outcomes. You can see that the line didn't favor. So actually more in the usual care, slightly more in the usual care, had better outcome than the very early mobilization. So kind of a bummer. So when you take a little closer look at that study specifically, it's interesting, you'll find that the Median time to first mobilization in the very early group, they definitely met their target. It was 18.5 hours. But in the usual care group, their median time to first mobilization was 22 hours. So by definition, they met the goal of the intervention group. In addition, it took them 8 years to enroll everybody into this trial. And the researchers had the foresight to document how quick every year are we getting the usual care group up out of bed. And every year they got faster by a half hour. So you could imagine enrolled on the eighth year compared to the first year, your time out of bed was 4 hours earlier. And this is in the usual care group or the control group. So a little contamination effect. They also had just 3% more smokers in the very early group, and then they had 3% more of the hemorrhagic stroke subtype in the very early group as well. So as I mentioned, they did a kind of a protocol-based dose dependent rehab intervention based on that patient's functional status, and that was applied to everybody, both groups. And when they went back and did kind of a retrospective dose response analysis, and you keep these two factors, time to first mobilization and minutes out of bed, you keep those constant and just look at the additional number of sessions they got. You had a small but marginal increase in odd of having a better outcome, but meeting statistical significance. Alternatively, if you were to keep the number of sessions constant, keep that time to first mobilization constant as well, and just look at the amount of time you kept them out of bed during that hospital stay, you had, again, small but slight reduction actually in the odd of having a better outcome to statistical significance. The conclusion proposed at the end of this kind of follow-up paper was that maybe the best thing would be a fine balance of frequent, short sessions of rehab, leaving the optimal time to mobilization slightly still mysterious. But based on what we understand about the nature of neurons, they're not wanting to be idle. They need a role. The biology post-stroke has this interesting parallel to that of development, where there seems to be a good reason for a critical period of optimal response to therapy. Based on the trials that I mentioned to you, it seems maybe the best, though the clinical significance of it was small, but maybe frequent, shorter sessions of rehab would be optimal. And then time to first mobilization, based on at least the initial phase two, the within 24-hour target seems to be fair and safe. And I think the only thing to apply, again, we've talked all day about individualizing your care to the patient that's in front of you, is to ensure clinical stability. So once earlier mentioned, trivial measure of raising the head of bed, if they're symptomatic from that, if they're clearly perfusion dependent, that patient may not be ready to come out of bed yet. Thank you.